The device pair is successful.
Welcome. We'll start with the class today. And what we would be doing is we would be working on the questions related to aptitude and reasoning. What we would be introducing is a kind of diversified set of questions which are commonly asked for your aptitude and reasoning section. A lot of students have questions and issues regarding that. So let's discuss some of the questions here. This would give you a kind of pretty good idea about as to what kind of questions come up in the examination and what kind of questions do you exactly need to work on. Okay. So we have the first question up here. Now this question says the sum of the ages of 5 children born at an interval of 4 years each is 85 years. What is the age of the youngest child? Now, how do you solve a question like this? Now, this is a kind of very simple question. What I need to do is I have 5 children. So let the first children's age be X. So the next children would be X plus 4. The next children would be X plus 8 and so on. So we will have 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 children. So you would have X plus 12 and X plus 16. Now this whole sum would be equal to 85, which is the total years. Okay. So now ECOS has a question, what would be the cutoff? So still, this is the first time you are having a question with 50, you are having a paper with 50 questions and not even the paper has come out yet. So predicting cutoff at this point of time is too early. So right now, oh great, Anuja, the correct answer is C, good. So you have 9 years. Great going. So you have 9 years as the correct answer here. So once you calculate this, you would have X is equal to 9 years. Fine. Now, considering the fact that you are having questions like these in the aptitude examination or your NET examinations or any other examination that you are preparing for, we would be trying to cover the kind of variety of questions that come up. So let's have questions from different facets. Now this question is a question from a kind of direction problem. So just read this question and try to work around this. Meanwhile, I just have a kind of small announcement for you. We would have the data interpretation class tomorrow. So all the students who are part of the mock test series and the other students who have been constantly asking for the DI solutions, we'll be covering the DI solutions tomorrow at 11. So it would be a kind of live stream again. And then Wednesday to Friday, we would have 9:30 a.m. every day with a live stream on different topics like polity and computers. So just check those out and we would understand as to how to work around those. Okay, so we have the next question here. So the next question here is, Ria started walking from her house southwards. Now, what we are trying to do is, I'm trying to just create a diagram here. So let's move step by step. I'm looking for the answers if anyone has as of now. Okay, if not, we'll try to solve this question. So Ria starts to walk from her house southwards. Now let's say this is the position. She walks 8 kilometers south. Then she turns to her left. Sorry, it's his everywhere, so it should be her. Okay, so she turns to her left. So now she's in the south. Oh, great, Aditya. The correct answer is A, great. She moves 6 kilometers. So she is moving 6 kilometers. Then after moving here, she walked 5 kilometers and she turned left. Now right is here, left is here. So she turned 5 kilometers and walked left. And then she continued for 10 kilometers to the left again. And that is 10 kilometers. Now since this is 5, this would be 5 and this would be 5 again. Now this is 6. Okay, so this is 6, so this is 6, so this would be 4, this is 5 and this was 8, so this would be 3. So you have to find a kind of hypotenuse for this right angle triangle. The two sides are 3 and 4, so the fifth side would be 5, that is 3 square plus 4 square under root, and that would be 25 under root, that would be 5. So 5 kilometers would be the distance from the house. Okay. The next question we have is, Now, this is a kind of question from alphabet series. All of the questions we are covering here have already been discussed in various videos, means not the same questions, but the patterns to solve these questions. So for the previous question, if you want, you can refer the direction problem. For this question, if you want, you can refer the class on alphabet series. Okay. Now, here again, the question is pretty simple. You have Spanish that is coded in certain fashion. What would be the code for scholar? Now, what we are trying to do is, if I work around Spanish here and you have U-R-C-N-H-R-G, okay, so G, the immediate next letter is H, the immediate next letter is G, S-R-I-J-H, okay, and here you have, you leave one and you have C, you leave one P-Q-R S-T-U, so you are leaving one in between, N remains N is it as it is, okay, and that's the case that you have here. So you have one letter in between, you have the immediate next letter here, and similarly you would have scholar, so O would remain O as such. So in which of the choices O remains O? So O remains O in first choice, so therefore Divya, great, so A is the answer, great going. Okay, so all of you have the answer for this question. This seemed to be easy. Now, this is again an interesting question. You have a science fair where you have students which are arranged in various rows. Now, just read the question for a while. I'll have it to you and let's see how you can work around this question. You have to find the number of children in each row of the square. So, how do you proceed with this question? Question number 4. We are on question number 4. The instructor finds out that 8 children are left out. So first of all, what we do is 7064 minus 8, because 8 of the children are left out. For 8, so Akshay, Sheetal, is this the answer for question number 3 or question number 4? Just mention the question number along with the answer so it would be easier for us to understand. Now, since 8 students are left out, what would be the number of students? It would be 7056. Now, this 7056 is equally arranged in the rows and columns. So, x into x, I can say, would be 7056. So, under root of 7056 would give you the correct answer, and that's the way you solve it. Now, coming on to the choices, how should you predict the choices? Question 4, the correct answer you have given is B, Anuja, great, good. So, I hope none of you are using calculators. Okay, so what we do is, you can use a kind of simple approximation to understand here. Since the choices are way off, one is around 40, one is around 60, 70 and 80, we can easily demarcate those. If the choices were close by, we would have to exactly find out the values. So, that's the basic difference that we need to understand here. Great going, a lot of you have the correct answer here. Good, good. It seems to be a tough competition for this net. Okay. Coming on to the next question. Now, this question, even if you do it without solving, you could come up with the approximations. Because since only two of the choices are close by, we can easily predict the answer. But still, in this kind of question, a better suggested way is to go and solve the question. So, you have 1 kilogram of adulterated rice, which has 2.4% stones, and the rest is rice. So, first of all, what we would do, great, Anuja, great, you are not using calculators and calculating it by the last digit. That's the best way to solve a kind of problem. Excellent going. Okay, so you have the next question here. So what we are trying to do is, we are trying to find out the weight of the stone, first of all. So weight of the stone in 1 kg would be how much? In 1 kg, you would have 2.4% of the stone. That means 24 grams is the stone. So, what is the actual weight or the unadulterated weight? That would be 1000 minus 24. So, once you solve it, you would have 976 as the answer here. Now, this 976 is the unadulterated, okay? Now, since you have 976 as the unadulterated one and you are saying half of the stone content was removed. So, you had 24 grams of stone. Now, out of these 24 grams, you now have just 12 grams of stones that is left. Now, how do I calculate this 12 grams? Now, my total weight would increase. So, this would be 976 plus 12 grams. That would be my total weight. And I have to find out the percentage of the stone. So, that would be 12 divided by the total weight into 100. Now, when I solve it, it would be approximately close to half the value of this, because the base value would come up around 988. In the previous case, it was 1000. So, when it was 1000, the value was 2.4. Now, when it is a little less than 1000, the value would be little more than the half. So, exact half would be 1.2. So, a little more than the half should be approximately 1.21. So, that's how. Oh, great, Shreya, Sakshi, a lot of you have a right answer here. Great going, great going. Okay, some of you have a comment that you don't like numbers. Okay, don't be afraid of the numbers. Just work around the question. And some of the questions, as we said, like question like this can be solved by a simple logic. You need not to even calculate. You can just read the question and see if this is a kind of marginal proportion that's there. The answer would be very close to the original value that is put up in the question. Okay. The next question, you have a kind of transaction that is explained. So, just read the question for a while. I'll leave it to you. Okay. Now, in this questions like this, we have to assume the initial value as 100. So, let me assume the cost price is 100. You have a profit of 60% that occurs. So, my selling price here is 160. Okay, if the cost, so initial cost was 100, my new cost is 120 and my selling price remains the same. So, my selling price remains 160 only. So, what's my profit margin here? My profit margin here is only 40. Here it was 60. Okay, so getting the point? Now, you have a hint here. Okay, now can you think about what we would do next year? So, since you have a decrease in the profit that is registered, and you have to find out how much decrease in the profit. So, decrease in the profit is how much? The original case profit was 60, the new case the profit is 40. So, it would be 60 minus 40 divided by 60 into 100, as simple as that. So, 20 by 60 into 100, so 1 by 3 into 100, that is 33.3%. So, 33.3% A would be the correct answer, correct journalism. So, okay. So, that's the correct answer here. Okay. I hope it was clear. It's again a kind of very simple question. You need not to apply a lot of maths. A simple logic could help you derive it. So, in the initial case, let me consider as cost price is 100. My profit is 60%. So, my selling price becomes 160. Now, my selling price is 160 in the second case also, but my cost price increases to 120. Therefore, my profit becomes 40 here and it was 60 here. What I need to find out is how much decrease in the profit is there. So, decrease in the profit would be 60 minus 40 divided by 60 into 100, and that's how we solve this question. Okay, great. So, the next question here is, this is again a question which is a kind of commonly asked question. The only thing you need to do here is do a bit of calculation that's required. So, a population of a town is 2.4 lakhs 3 years ago. If the increase is 4%, 2.5 and 5% respectively in the last 3 years, how do you calculate the percentage? So, how do you calculate the percentage here? So, it's kind of very simple question. You have 2,40,000 as the value. Now, what you would do is, in the first case, it would be 1 plus 4%. In the second case, it would be 1.25%. And in the third case, it would be 1 plus 5%. So, that's how you calculate it. Okay, and then try to solve the problem. So, in either case, the value would be higher than the base value. So, if you have the choices that are there, you can easily eliminate that. Now, since you are using just a kind of percentage, which is very small as compared to main value, this value could not be doubled out. So, the values which are close to double could be easily ignored. Oh, great, Akash, you have D. I hope you did it by approximation technique. So, when you have the choices that are far away, the best way you can do is approximate. Because since I am doing 4%, 2.5% and 5% of every new value. So, let's say 2.4 lakhs, I am calculating 4%. I am adding that 4% to 2.4 lakh, and then I am doing a 2.5% of it, and so on and so forth. So my value cannot be a kind of double value. So A and C could easily be ignored out. Okay, and then I need to solve out based on approximation. So that's the correct way of solving it. Some of you have already done it. Great, great. Okay. So the next question here is, now this is a kind of very interesting problem. This is a problem where you have the total number of matches. So make sure you don't get confused here. Read the question carefully. You have the total number of tournaments, that is 55 matches that are played. Each team plays once against the other team. So let's say I explain it in this way. You have three teams. So this team plays against this and this team plays against this, but that's one and the same thing. So I'll count this as one. I'll count this as again one. So either this playing with this or this playing with this would be counted as one. And this would be again counted as one. So what I need to do here is I would just calculate the number of games that would be played. And that number of games would be n minus 1 by 2. And that would be equal to how many matches played? 55. So n minus 1 would be 110. So n square minus n would be 110. Now what could be the values of n? The values of n could be factors of 110. So factors of 110 would be 10 and 11. Now one would be negative, the other would be positive. So let's say if 11 is positive, it would be 121 minus 11, and that's equal to 110. So that comes out to be the correct answer. So 11 would be the correct answer. Question number 8, C, Jaya has said C, but the 10 would be negative 10. So it would be minus 10, because only if it is minus 10, my value would come out to be 110. Okay, so since n would be minus 10, you cannot consider that as the correct answer. You will have to take out the positive value. Deepika, correct. Pooja, Shreya, great. So the correct answer would be A here. I hope you understand why we have ignored 10. We have ignored 10 because 10 would be negative in this case. So negative 10 square, that's 100. Minus 10, and that gives me 110. So only when the value of 10 is negative 10, we consider this. And since we have the number of teams, it has to be positive. So we would take positive. Okay, great, Jaya. Great. So the next question here is, again, a question. Some of you might be afraid reading this question, considering that this is a question from probability. So this has nothing to do with probability, just a simple logic that you have to apply and solve it. Just read the question. I've already given you a hint to solve this question. Usually when a question comes with red blue balls or something like that, students get confused or afraid, considering that this is a question from probability, but not at all. So just try how to work around this. Now here, a bag contains only three colors of balls: red, blue and green. The first statement say I say all but 18 are blue. What does that mean? It means all the balls but 18 of them are blue. So let's say red plus green are 18. The second says all but 15 are red. So you have, let's say, green plus blue would be 15, and the last statement would be red plus blue would be 13. Now solving this, I can find out how many red colored balls would be there. So it's a kind of very simple question that we need to work around, and it has nothing to do with the basically the idea of logic, combination. Okay, so for the ninth question, the correct answer would be 8. So the number of red balls here would be 8. Solving this, we can easily calculate that. Okay, so just solve this and you would have 8 as the correct answer. The next question, the area of a rectangular field whose length is 5 times the breadth is this much. Find the perimeter. Now again, a very simple question. Since it's a rectangular field, what would happen? You would have area would be multiplication of length and breadth. So I can say x into 5x would be 6125. So 6125 divided by 5 under root would be the value for x. Now since I have the value for x, what I would do is 5 times the value of x would be the basically the other side, and two twice the length plus breadth would be my answer for the perimeter, and that's how we calculate it. So again, a kind of very simple question that you have here. Okay, so you have to calculate x square. So I just divide it. I would have 1225. The under root of 1225 I'll have to calculate. So for 10th question, I already have the answers. So the answer is C. So some of you have given C as the answer. That's not the right answer. We have to calculate the perimeter. So it's 2 length plus breadth. So when I say 2 length plus breadth, it would be just do it again. I guess some of you are missing the twice value. Okay, I'll repeat it again. Some of you have the confusion. Okay, so what the question says, you have the area of the rectangular field whose length is 5 times the breadth. So let the breadth be x. The length here would become 5x. Now what's the area? So area is length into breadth, and that's 6125. Now since the length and the breadth are given, so it's x and 5x, I can say x multiplied by 5x would be 6125. Fine. So what I calculate is, I calculate it as x square would be equal to 6125 divided by 5, and that would be equal to 1225. Now from this I can calculate x. X would be under root of this 1225. And since we know for under root, if I do it for 30, what it would be? 30 into 30, how much it would be? It would be 900. Okay, so this value should be more than 30. If I do 40 into 40, how much it would be? It would be 1600. So this value would be somewhere between 30 and 40. So let's try it with 35, and once you try it with 35, you have x is equal to 35, because 35 square would be 1225. Now since x is 35, how do I calculate the perimeter? The question says perimeter. So perimeter is twice length plus breadth. Now how do I calculate it? It would be twice, that's 35 plus 35 into 5, that's 70, 140, 140 plus 35, that's 185. So 35 plus 185, and that would be 210. So twice of 210 would be 420. So the perimeter would be 420. I hope that's clear now. I guess some of you previously mentioned about question number 9. So question number 9, as I said, is a very simple question. I'll just go back to question number 9. There was a request to repeat it. Okay, so here what you are trying to do is, this question has nothing to do with probability. I'm just saying I have a bag where I have only 3 colors of balls. Okay, it's red, green and blue. Now since it's only 3 colors of balls that are there, what we can do is, we can say in the first case all but 18 are blue. So leaving all, you have red plus green, that would be 18. All but 18 are blue. So that's what we have as blue. Okay. The next is, similarly we do it for all the 3. So you have green plus blue, that would be 15, and red plus blue, that would be 13. Now solving this, I have to calculate the R value. Okay. So I'll just form 2 equations there and solve it. Okay, question number 9, I hope that was clear. So it's a kind of simple 3 equations with 3 variables. You have to find what is R here. Just solve it and it should be all set. Okay, now coming on to the next question here. This is a kind of very direct question, a kind of series question that's there, alphabet series questions again. Okay, so alphabet series question usually are part of your NET examination. So every time you have one question from alphabet series, one question either from blood relation or from the section on direction. So just take a note of those. So in this, what we are doing is, in one of the series, we are going in an increasing order. In the other series, we are going in a decreasing order. So we are moving from D to I with plus 5 and W to R with minus 5, and the series goes on. So you have plus 5 minus 5 series, that is gone. Okay. So I hope that's clear. Now, once you have this, you can just mark the letters and solve it. So you would have the answer, a kind of very direct question here. Now, this is a question from Square of Opposition. I have come up with numerous doubts where students have understanding whether this is a question from Square of Opposition or this is a question from syllogism. So a simple way to understand it, for the questions from syllogism, you would have three variables that would be given in two sentences. That's the key idea. So you have, let's say, flower red, blue. Okay, so there are three variables and given in two sentences. Some flowers are red, some flowers are blue. Now I have flowers, flowers, and red and blue. So three variables in two sentences, and then we apply the issues on syllogism. But for a problem like this, where we say we are trying to find out the relation between some salamanders are not yellow and some are yellow. So what we do under Square of Opposition is we simply try to understand it as universal. The above one is universal, the below one is particular, the left one is affirmative and negative. So you have all, none, some, and some not. So that's the simplest way to understand it. And here we are saying there is a relation between some and some not. So some salamanders are not yellow and some salamanders are yellow. So we are trying to establish a relation between these two. And this relationship would be a kind of subcontrary relationship. A karamveer great. So that's the correct answer. Balram, these classes would be in English only, but I'm trying to bring up it in the simplest English. So I hope this shouldn't be a problem. So for understanding this, we would be having a close view on the Square of Opposition, a very important topic for your NET. Every time you have 1 to 2 questions from Square of Opposition directly and indirectly, and many of the questions students are confused as to where to apply Square of Opposition and where to apply syllogism. So we have next question for syllogism problem here. So you have a following syllogism test for validity. Now here we have clearly mentioned that it's a problem of syllogism. Even if not, we would understand it. We have three variables, North American, tall, and Canada in two sentences. So that's how we work around this. So let me give you a few seconds to solve this. So we have a kind of video series for 4 syllogism lectures. So just go across all those 4 and 2 for Square of Opposition. So that's the correct way of doing it, okay? So 13th problem, okay, I already have the answers for 13. No, A is not the correct answer, Anil, for 13. Just try to work around it again. So many of the students are working on the rings. They are drawing one ring within the other and so on. So that's not the correct way of solving a syllogism problem. So syllogism we already talked about in our lectures. That's the correct way of doing it is this way. So let's say North Americans, Canadians, and tall. Now let me say the first statement. So first we do with the the universal statements, and then we move for the particular statements. So all Canadians are North American. So all the Canadians should be North American. So none of the Canadians would lie in this region. I'll ignore this region. Then I say some North Americans are tall. So North Americans and tall, they could be here, they could be here. So what I do is I mark a cross in between these two lines. Now since oh great, many D's. So D is the correct answer here. Okay, good, great going. Okay, so what we do is, based on this, I can say all Canadians are North Americans. So all Canadians are North Americans is something that's given already in the question. So it's not the test for syllogism. All tall are Canadians. So all tall are Canadians. That's also incorrect because we don't have the correct answer here. All North American are tall. We cannot say anything about North American, whether all of them are tall or not. We just say some of the North Americans are tall. Some Canadians or tall people are North Americans. So this I can say there are some Canadians and some tall people who are North Americans. That's given here. So some Canadian and some tall people are North Americans, and that's true. So D becomes the correct statement. Great going. So now all of you have the correct answer for this. So again, I repeat, this is the only correct way of solving a syllogism problem. This is a kind of coding decoding problem that's related to the relationships. Okay, so now this is not a kind of coding decoding, sorry, we would have another problems for coding decoding. This is a kind of direct problem for blood relation. So what we need to do here is K is the sister of L and M, so all of them in one line. So let's first understand that what we need to draw in one line and what we need to draw up and down. So K is the sister of L and M, so K is the sister, L and M can be sister or brother, we don't know anything about them. So they could be daughter or son, that's the way I can write. N is the mother of M, so mother is N and O is K's father, so K's father is O. Now since they are brother and sister, they become the husband and wife, and this is female and this is male, that's how we can depict it. Okay, now which of the following statement cannot be definitely true? So B, okay, Akash, great. So B, that says O is L's daughter. So L is O's daughter. So L is O's daughter, that's something I cannot say because I don't know whether this L is a son or a daughter. As we said, they are three brothers and sisters and K is the sister. So L can be brother, M can be brother, L can be sister, M can be sister. So they could be either brother or sister, we don't know. So they could be daughter or son for O. So we don't know whether they are daughter or whether they are son. So B is something which cannot be definitely true. So B becomes your right answer. Great. A lot of you have the correct answer here. Good going. The next question is, again, a very simple problem, but I have seen many of the students were struck with problems like this. So yes, Navneet, S gender is not defined. So that's the only key thing or the key takeaway that you need to have. So today is Friday. After 62 days, what would be the day? Now, this is a kind of very, very simple problem. I just give you 10 seconds to work around and let's see who brings up the answer first for the 15th question. 15th question C. Great, Arshana. Okay, so Arshana, the only thing that you need to understand here is we need to understand 7 days in a week, so table of 7. So 63 comes in the table of 7, so 7 nines are 63. So 63 would be Friday, a day before 63 would be 62 and that would be Thursday, as simple as that. Okay, great. Lot of you have the right answers here. The next is, you have a series that's given. Now what you have to find out is the number in the next series. Again, a pretty very simple question. Yes, Navneet. So Navneet is helping me out. Great, thanks Navneet. So you are giving the exact points to the line, kind of log line sentences there. Okay, so what's the missing number here? Okay, so missing number here would be, what we are trying to do is, I'm trying to form a series which is cube minus 1. So you have 8 cube minus 1, that's, sorry, 2 cube, that's 8, 8 minus 1, that's 7. 3 cube, that's 27, 27 minus 1 is 26. So it's as simple as that, 2 cube minus 1, 3 cube minus 1, 4 cube minus 1. So you will have 5 cube minus 1, so 125 minus 1, that's 124. So 124 A would be the correct answer, Karamveer, great going. Okay, great. So you have that as the correct answer. Now this is a very tricky question. Read this question carefully. I understand many of the students would be confused here. So just take a while to read this question very carefully and understand. So I'll be explaining this one by one. So what we are trying to do is, we have four couples which are sitting on a circular table. Every husband sits to the right of the wife. So let's say you have 8 couples, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. Husband to the right of wife, husband to the right of wife, husband to the right of wife, husband to the right of wife. Okay, so that's the arrangement we have. Okay, so are you able to see the question for question number 17? Okay. I'm just moving the question. I hope it's clear now. Okay, just read the question. You have four couples sitting around a circular table in the restaurant. every husband sits to the right of the wife. So I'll solve along with you. Since we do not have a lot of time, since your exam is close by, we'll be solving the question together, okay? I won't be giving you time to solve it as always, okay? So what we are doing is, we are making eight people sit, husband next to the wife, husband next to the wife. Now A, B, C and D are husband, P, Q, R and S are wives. B, Q and C, R are two married couple. D does not sit next to R. P sits to the left of A, who sits opposite to D. Now P sits to the left of A. So let me consider A here. So P would sit to the left of A, and A who sits opposite to D. So D would be here. So I have AD as the option here, and P that's sitting here. Now I say BQ and CR are the couples. So this should be BQ and CR as the couple. So the only one left for D would be P is occupied, Q and R are occupied. So the only one who remains with D would be S. So S should be here. Now I say D does not sit next to R. So R cannot be here. R cannot be here. So where could be R? R could be here. So R could be here, since R is here and C and R are married couples, C would be here, and here it would be B would be husband and Q would be wife. So I have the arrangement for all of those. Now the question says B sits in between. So this B is sitting between Q and P. So Q and P becomes the correct answer. Shruti, you have Q and P becomes the correct answer for this question. That's B. Yeah, Karamveer, B, Sakshi, correct. Okay, great. I hope this question was clear. I'll repeat this question again, a kind of tricky and important question for your analytical section. You have every time 1 to 2 questions from analytical. So you have husband and wife pairs that are sitting. Okay, you move from the last sentence that helps you solve the problem in the easiest way. P sits to the left of A, so you have A and P to the left, and A is opposite to D, so A is here, D is here. Then you say D does not sit next to the R, so R cannot be here, okay, and R cannot be here. So where could be the only case for R? The only case for R could be here. You have four wives, one is already occupied as P. The two options for R to be sitting are this and this, but since R cannot be close to D, R cannot sit here, R cannot sit here, so the only space left for R would be here. C and R are couples, so they sit together, so that would be the correct answer. And then you have B and Q as a couple, so they would be again together, so S would be here, and that's how you arrange it. So once you arrange it, you can move forward, okay? The next is again a question on direction, a very simple question on direction. Just read it for a while and it would be all set. So you have to say from which direction did I start my journey, and you have the choices as the direction, not the values. So I say after walking 8 kilometers, so let's say I walk 8 kilometers, I turn to my right, I walk 3 kilometers, then I turn to my left and walk 10 kilometers. Once I have 10 kilometers, I turn to my right, left again, upside, and walk 5 kilometers. So that's here. In the end, I was moving towards the north. So when I'm here, I'm moving towards north. So from which direction did I start my journey? So I started my journey from this direction. So this direction would be which direction? It would be the west direction. So you have question number 18. You have the direction of A. Direction in which the person started would be the west. So it's moving towards the this side, and it's in the west. So where did he start? As the west, and he is finally towards the north. So great, Sakshi, that's the correct answer. Okay, the next question here is, this is a question again from the direction, but talking about sunrise and sunset. A lot of the students are confused here. So just read the question for a while. I'll just scroll it down in case you're not able to see. Okay. So just read the question. One morning after sunrise, Sita started to walk. During their walk, she met Aneri, who was coming from opposite direction. So you have to understand the direction. So let's say Sita is walking, okay, and she meets Aneri, who was coming from the opposite direction. So let's say this is Aneri, this is Sita. Sita is walking from the north, and you have the direction that could be seen for the Aneri, that's opposite. Sita watches the shadow of Aneri to the right of Sita. So Sita sees the shadow here. So this is the side where you are having the shadow, that's the right of the Sita. So Sita is coming from the north, so right of her would be the hand in which I have the pen. So this would be the place where you are having the shadow, and this would be the region where you have the sunrise. So that is how you work around the sunrise sunset problem. So that's in the east. Now, in which direction is Aneri from the Sita? So Aneri is south of Sita. Okay, so that's how we understand Aneri is standing south of Sita. Now, one of you, Pooja, has a question where to start, north or east. Okay, so I'm saying you have to understand this only by the shadow. So Sita watches the shadow of Aneri to the right of her, and this is morning. So morning you would have sunrise in the east, and the shadow is towards the right of Sita. So right of Sita would be only in the case when Sita is in the north. Okay. When the Sita is in the north, the shadow would be seen towards the right of Sita here. And therefore, when you have this location, that's clear, you can understand you would have Aneri that's located in the south. So in which direction is Aneri from Sita? So Aneri is in the south from Sita. Okay. Pooja is asking about the previous question. Okay, so previous question, in the end you are moving towards north, so you started from a point somewhere in the west, and that's why you have west as the correct answer. In question number 18, question number 18, you are saying why can't we start from north? No, you cannot start from north, because if you are starting from the north, in the end you won't have north as one of the directions. So you are having the last direction is north. So last direction as north would be possible only when you are moving from the west. If you can try it, you can draw it again, and your answer won't come up to be north if you are moving from the north in the first case. So if I start from the north, I won't end up in the north in that case. You can just solve it. Still, if you have problem, you can just put it in the comment box again after the class. Okay. The next question here is, this is a kind of very interesting question and a very simple question. The question looks bulky because there is too much information that's given here. But this is a kind of very, very simple question. King Avi has a question to has a doubt about 19th question. So 19th question, I repeat, it's a kind of very simple question. Others can read question number 20 by the time. So question number 19, what we are trying to do is we are trying to understand that sun rises, since it's morning, sun rises in the east. So the shadow is on the west. Now Sita is seeing the shadow towards her right. Now the only case in which Sita would see the shadow towards her right would be the case when Sita is in the north. So when Sita is in the north, she would find the shadow in the right of her, and when she is seeing the southwards, and since Aneri is coming from the south, the direction of Aneri with respect to Sita would be from the south. Okay. Coming on to this question, this is a very interesting question. Now children are in the pursuit of dog whose leash has broken. A is directly behind the dog. So let's say this is dog. A is directly behind the dog. B is behind A. C is behind B. So that's the order. D is ahead of dog. So that's the order. Walking down in the street in opposite direction. Now as the children and the dog passes, D turns around and joins the pursuit. So he runs behind B. So D joins here. He runs behind B. A runs faster and is alongside the dog on the left. So A is on the left. So A goes here. A is not here. And B runs faster and is alongside the dog on the right. So B goes on the right of the dog. So A, B and dog are running parallel. So which child is alongside the right? Now, which child is directly behind the dog? So, who is left? A is gone, B is gone. So, D comes up. So, which child is directly behind the dog would be D. That's choice C. Now, this is an important question because many of you would see the answer as D. But while marking, they would mark the choice as incorrect. So, where is D choice is coming is in the choice C. So, you have to be very careful while marking the choices. Okay. So, choices are very, very important in confusing questions like this. The next is again a kind of very simple series. So, there are two ways of solving it. The first way, I would say that's the easiest way to do it. So, just add the numbers. So, 1 plus 8 is 9. 2 plus 7 is 9, 3 plus 6 is 9, 5 plus 4 is 9. So, 4 plus 5 would be again 9, or any two numbers whose sum comes up to be 9 would be the answer. So, 72 would be the correct answer. So, 72 you would have sum as 9. A very simple question from a simple reasoning problem. Now, this question is a pretty interesting question. I want you to read it for a while and then we'll discuss it. Okay. So, every birthday my mother has seen that okay, yes, great. So, 22, let's move on to 22. So, 21 was pretty simple. Many correct answers there. Okay, 22, we have every birthday of the life, the mother has seen that my cake contains my age in candles. Starting my fourth birthday, I have always blown out my candles. Okay. Before that, I averaged a 50% of the total blowout rate. So far, I have blown 900 candles. What's my age? Question 22, has anyone read it? Okay, I have the answers from a lot of you. Okay, great, 42, great going, great, great. So what we are trying to understand here is, I am saying I have to find out the first, the number of candles that I am blowing is equal to my age. So let's say if I am 10 years old, I am blowing 10 candles. 11 years, I am blowing 11 candles. So that's a kind of simple series that we need to understand. So it would be n plus 1 by 2. Now that's the number of candles that I put up. However, for the first 3 years, what I am trying to do is I am blowing just 50%. So first year, second year and third year, I am just blowing half of the original number of candles that I could, and that comes out to be the total candles, that's 900. Now once I have this equation, I'll try to solve it. So it would be n plus 1, that would be 1806. Now how do I solve this? Now this is again very, very important. Now how do I find out what should be the n here? Now since I have a quadratic equation, one way is I can just spend a little time and solve this quadratic equation. The other is to look at the last digit. So since the last digit is 6, that could be factors of 6. So 2 and 3 could be the factors of 6. Now what I take into account is I try to apply those from the choices given. So let's say if I take one number as 42, the other number would be 43, I try solving 42 and 43 and see if that comes out to be the answer, and that works out, then you have the correct answer that could be seen here. Okay. So that's how we work on the questions like this, a kind of interesting question that's there. The next question, again a very simple question but a kind of interesting question. We have to find out how many numbers are there from 1 to 1000 which are both perfect squares and perfect cube. Now any number which is both perfect square and perfect cube, what I will do, it should be n square as well as n cube, both of those. So I'll take the LCM of 2 and 3, so that would be 6. So n raised to 6 would be the correct answer. Now since I have to find out a number which is n raised to 6 and which lies between 1 to 1000, so I'll just find out by the various combinations what would be the number. So I'll try it with 2 raised to 6, 4 raised to 6, 3 raised to 6 and see what comes up. So we'll have 3 as the correct option. So we'll have 3 raised to power 6, and that accounts for 3 into 3 into 3, that's 9, 9 into 3, 27, so 27 into 27, and that would be 729, and 729 lies between 1 and 1000. So you would have three great Rohan Jaya. So Rohini Jaya, great. So we have three as the correct answer, because we have to find out a number which is both perfect square and a perfect cube as well. Okay, clear? The next question, again a very simple question. The total ages of A, B and C is 65 years. What is the total ages 3 years ago? Now, a very simple question. You don't have to do anything. Simply, I can say A plus B plus C is 65 as of now. So, 3 years ago, I would subtract 3 from all the ages. So, how much I would subtract is 9 from this 65, and that would be my sum of total ages 3 years back. If I was asked sum of ages after 3 years, it would be, I would add 3 plus 3 plus 3, that's 9. So, 65 plus 9, that would be 74, and that would be the correct answer. I hope that was clear, a kind of very simple problem. Oh great, Anjali, Karamveer, Anuja, Jaya. Okay, so you have 56 as the correct answer here. The last question for today, there are 58 marbles in a jar. Again, a very interesting question. Read this question, listen this question very carefully. I'll just scroll it down to help you. Okay, there are 58 marbles in a jar. First person took one marble, and each consecutive person took more marbles than the first person until the jar is empty. What is the largest number of people that can that could have taken the marbles from the jar? A kind of very simple question, the last question. What we are trying to say here is, first person is picking 1, second will pick 2, third will pick 3, fourth will pick 4, and so on. So what I'll do is 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 and so on, I'll proceed. Total there are 58 marbles that are there. Now what I would do is, I'll keep proceeding till the value is less than 58 and all the persons are able to pick up a marble. So the 10th person would have how many marbles that would be left for the 10th person? So the 10th person, you would have 1 plus 2 plus till 9. So you would have 45. So you would have 45 minus this. That would be 13. So 13 marbles are left. So 10th person can pick up 10 marbles from there and he would be all set. So after 9 people, 10th person can also pick up the marble. But 11th person won't have sufficient number of marbles, because from this 13, 10 will be gone. So only 3 would be left. So for 11th person, you should have 11 marbles, but there are only 3 that remains. So you would have 10th person. So how many, what's the largest number of people that could take the marble from the jar would be 10 persons. Okay, so that's the correct answer here. You would have 10 persons that would be able to take the marbles from the jar. I hope it was clear. As we said, tomorrow we would be working with data interpretation problems, and we would have nearly 25 questions for the data interpretation. Excuse me. So just join us at 11. We would be working with DI problems as requested by a lot of you. And on Wednesday, Thursday and Friday, we would have again the live stream for Polity Computers and Teaching Research. So do join us. Have a great day.